Let me begin by defining my term here. By consciousness, I mean experience. You wake up from dreamless sleep, suddenly there is something rather than nothing. That is having an experience, whether it's simple, like darkness and silence, or very complicated, or a beautiful mountain in front of you. You don't need to think about it. You might, but you don't need to. You don't even need to look at the real world. It might be a dream. It's just colors, shapes, motions, anything of the sort is an experience. So that's what consciousness is at the fundamental level. And as we heard many times here, we're trying to figure out what is the place of experience in a physical world. And I want to just briefly remind you of what is the object we are dealing with, which we now know is clearly crucial for having any sort of experience. So the brain has roughly 100 billion neurons in humans, of which the vast majority, 70 billions, are down there in the cerebellum. Now, in cortex, we have 100 trillion synapses, the connections among neurons. So you get a sense of the complexity of the organ. And then if we look at the organization, we have these mini columns of a few hundred neurons. Then there is the neuron, which everybody more or less thinks is the unit that really matters. And then we can go further down to synapses, molecules, and so on and so forth. Now, the hard problem that was presented and emphasized so much by David Chalmers was also discussed in a way by Leibniz many years ago. And he had this metaphor of the mill, such that he would go into a machine, really he thought the brain, enlarge it so he could look at all the parts. And for the brain, I think there are three interesting aspects here: constitution, process, and function. So if we look into the brain, what it is made of, constitution, you'll find indeed it's made of molecules that then make up, for instance, the presynaptic terminal vesicle here that release glutamate molecules and activate somehow the postsynaptic neuron. It's all made up of that kind of stuff and nothing more than that, no mysterious substances. If you look at process, we see that the neurons are on or off. Each of these is a spike, on or off. Mostly on, here in wake, here in sleep, they continue to be on even if you lose consciousness. So things happen all the time in the brain. And then we can also ask, as we heard this morning, what is the function it's performing? In fact, it's performing many functions. And these functions are clearly crucial for what we care about in terms of intelligence. Here, for instance, is recognition of scenes, saliency detection, etc. You can come up with all kinds of models about how the brain does that. So you go into the brain, you find what it's made of, what things happen, neurons firing and not, and what functions it might be performing. You do all of this, but in the end, you have no inkling that you need anything like consciousness. It doesn't seem to reside anywhere. And that's the hard problem, as discussed by David also on the first day. And so my opinion is, and his too, I would say, is that it's very difficult to squeeze consciousness out of the brain. You can look at all you want inside the brain, you won't find it there. And yet, we know it is the only thing that really matters in the end, because that's us. So here is a drawing by Ernst Mach, great physicist, who actually was looking from inside out. The experience is what he has, and you can wonder, where do you get it out from the brain? Nowhere, I think. That's an impossible problem. The way you should proceed is exactly the opposite. You should proceed from experience itself, ask what that is about, and then ask yourself, how does the physical world have to be in order to support experience without the physical requirements? That is the procedure that is taken by integrated information theory, or IIT. So it starts from consciousness itself, not from behavior, not functions, not constitution, not processes, and nothing of the sort in the brain. It asks what are the essential properties that are true of every experience. It then derives from these phenomenal properties, properties that are required of the physical subset of consciousness, and then checks whether that may indeed be correct. And I'll show you very briefly, has some predictive, explanatory, and inferential power. So here are the most important parts of the talk, and I will be very short about this. These are the axioms of IIT, which are five, and they essentially characterize what is true of every experience. There's a lot of work and alternatives into this, but let me just say that they are. That experience is for the subject, is subjective, is private, not for some external observer. It is for you. Second, it's structured. There are parts to it, the left and the right, the colors and the shapes, a book and a blue book, and so on and so forth. Parts and their relations. Third, It is the particular way it is. Each experience is what it is, this particular experience we are having, and thereby different from trillions of other experiences they are not having. Fourth, it's one. That is, you cannot subdivide it into non-interdependent components. Yes, you can talk about the left side and the right side of an experience, but they are two parts of the same experience. And finally, it is what it is, not less, not more. Here indicated like this, so if you experience something with color, the experience includes color. You cannot experience it without color. And vice versa, you cannot experience what you're experiencing now with added on, say, blood pressure, which is something our brain deals with all the time. So there are neurons that detect and regulate blood pressure, but it's just not part of your experience. So it is what it is, not less, not more. So in short, it exists, and it exists for the subject. It is structured, it is the way it is, it's specific, it is unitary, and it is definite. It is borders with things inside and things outside. So what IIT then tries to do is to translate this into the language of physics. And by that, I mean it in the most general sense. Physics as being things that we can actually show to have cause-effect power are part of the physical world, where by cause-effect power, I simply mean you can perform operations, you can manipulate, you can observe, you can cut, and sometimes you can fix. So with this definition, totally general, of what exists physically, which our postulate about what's out there, we can translate each of these axioms into postulates required of the physical substance of experience. And again, very, very quickly, I'll tell you by manipulation and observation, intrinsic existence translates into cause-effect power by saying, if you take a system, a very simple system, these are the ones we deal with because we know everything about them, like little binary units connected in a graph like that. Well, it has to have cause-effect power to exist, and to exist intrinsically, it must have it upon itself, not on an external observer. Composition means its parts must have cause-effect power within the system, each of every possible subset of parts. Information means that the cause-effect power has to be specific, one particular way, which is unfolded here in what's called the cause-effect structure by looking at the full set of constraints that the system in a state, these three elements, one on, two off, how they constrain their own past and future. That is the unfolding of the cause-effect power. It also needs to be integrated. If you can divide the system in two through a partition, and then you find that the cause-effect power, the structure, is unchanged, it means the whole does not exist. It's nothing above and beyond its parts. But if there is a residue, meaning if the cut does something, you lose something, then the system is to some extent integrated. And this integration of information measure is called phi. That's what phi measures. And finally, exclusion, it means that in principle you could consider any system, ABC, AB, ABCDE, you name it, you try all of them, but we know that what exists in consciousness is definite, it has borders, and so the borders, what actually exists out of the many competing entities, is the one that has maximum cause-effect power, intrinsic cause-effect power, which is what is measured here. It turns out it's this system here, which has this particular kind of cause-effect power. Now, all of this is not comprehensible in such a short time, so I invite you to go here, where Masahumi and Larissa, who are here, and I'll go in great detail and explain how this is calculated, and also on the website you will find the appropriate tools. But in the end, what it boils down to is that IIT says that an experience, say this experience, is identical in physical terms to a conceptual structure, which is this thing here, supported by a particular substrate of some elements in a state connected in a certain way. Each of the subset of the parts that have cause-effect power specifies is called a concept. The whole thing is a conceptual structure, and this is now the same thing plotted in cause-effect space where each axis is a possible past and future state of the system. And what it means is then that the quality of the experience, the way it feels, according to IIT, is given completely by this conceptual structure. These two formulations are equivalent. And the quantity of experience, how much you exist as a conscious entity, is given by its overall irreducibility, which is this big phi max. If you cut it, how much you lose for the minimum cut over the maximum set. Something of the sort. And now, what I want to illustrate very briefly then is, don't read this, just remember that going through these five postulates, we can test in principle a physical system, it's just very long to do, and we end up checking whether it satisfies all the properties we said, and we end up, if it satisfies all of them strongly, that is also exclusion strongly, it constitutes an intrinsic entity. We can say that that thing exists for itself as a maximally irreducible center of cause-effect power, and that is what consciousness is, and it exists in that particular way. So also interesting, given many of the conversation I should really have been saying something this morning in What Exists theme, it also allows you to identify things that are bona fide things out there with borders in the physical world, but if they don't have this maximum, they are local maxima, not global maxima, they exist for us, but not in and of themselves, and it makes all the difference in my mind. Now, three brief examples to show you that in principle, then, according to IIT, you need to go in, take a physical system, if you could, and unfold completely its cause-effect power by manipulating it and observing it and cutting it in all possible ways. Only when you do that do you really know what exists and if it exists intrinsically for itself and therefore is conscious. So I want to give you just two or three examples that illustrate that being is not the same as being made of, that is constitution. So consciousness is not just a substrate. So the brain may be made of molecules and atoms, but here I want to illustrate with two of these very, very simple networks that differ minimally from the point of view of a physical substrate. Copy gate, two on, two off, one majority gate at one particular time step. We tend to think that that's what there is. This is our model, but you need to unfold cause-effect power. And what actually exists here is a conceptual structure with four concepts. So it has a little bit of consciousness, in fact, one, and it has four concepts, four parts in it, so to speak. And when we do this for this system, deceivingly similar, it turns out it's radically different in terms of what exists intrinsically. This is not one entity. These are two entities, each of them little conscious with only two concepts each. So it's important to remember this is how we think of things, but if we really want to unfold the full physical cause-effect power, the picture can change dramatically. Dynamics, same story. I illustrated that, you know, neurons change all the time. They do all kinds of things. People think the processes are sort of fun and interesting and maybe sexy, while static things are not. Here is a system, again, very, very simple, of copy gates connected in this way, all units off. This is another system exactly identical, except we have now poison for a short time, so made in non-functional these synapses here, okay? Now, these two systems happen to be at the dynamical fixed point, meaning they stay in this state indefinitely unless there are external influences. So nothing is really happening there. And now this is a case of being versus happening, and what we will see is that we do a cause-effect power analysis. So over time, the system stays in that same state. This system, again, supports a conceptual structure. Even if there is no activity, nothing happening at all here. This is conscious, one, four concepts. That other system, same state, doesn't exist at all. There is nothing there, at least not for itself. Okay? And finally, importantly, consciousness does not identify with function or any functions. Here is the game, what I showed you before. One way of thinking about what the brain does is performs object recognition, decision making, you name it, all these complicated functions. And they might be implemented on the brain, as we heard this morning, like you know, software on hardware. Well, this is an example, again, in which we take one system which has a particular input-output function. It does certain things. And this is a different version which produces exactly the same input-output behavior. Somewhat more complicated system. This happens to be purely feed-forward. So from the extrinsic point of view, if this were a computer implementation of this, okay, they are functionally absolutely equivalent. But when we unfold their cause-effect power, this thing exists for itself. It has 5.79 and several concepts here. The other thing exists for us, but it doesn't exist for itself at all, phi equals zero, even though they perform absolutely identically. And here the point is precisely that, and we are, you know, essentially finalizing the paper showing this, that any architecture which is like a von Neumann computer, even though it is totally functionally equivalent to something it is simulating, so it's simulated perfectly, is not going to be conscious at all. It's going to have a phi of zero, only some components will have a non-zero phi. And even if you were to do a virtual brain, as people are trying to do, but it's a long way away, that is, simulate all the neurons and all the connections in your brain and run them in the computer so that necessarily it will behave like you, well, that thing will behave like you, but not be you. It would be, in fact, be nothing at all, okay? And this leads to a double dissociation between consciousness and intelligence. So far, we have been used to see high intelligence usually correlated with high consciousness, that's the case of humans, And by analogy, we suspect that that is probably true for maybe slightly less intelligent animals and so on and so forth. Maybe they are just slightly less conscious. Most arguments have been of this kind. But IIT says that you can have something which is as intelligent as we are or more one day, and that may be not conscious at all, a true zombie. And conversely, that you might have some simple physical systems, like the simple 2D grid here, that might actually have a reasonable degree of consciousness, while they do nothing special and they really have no particular function. So I will finish by a few predictions of IIT. So the basic prediction is consciousness should be a maximum of intrinsic cause effect power. Here we use a very crude measure, a phi surrogate, using TMS, transcranial magnetic stimulation that induces current. We record response with EEG, we do all kinds of things to accurately calculate what kind of brain can give that response. We get this index, which is high if there is high potential for information integration, low if there isn't. And this is now 200 subjects, essentially in many different conditions. The values of PCI are always high when the subject reports being conscious, whether it is a normal patient, a patient with some lesions, etc. And also, if you are dreaming and unresponsive and not directing attention to the world, even ketamine anesthesia, while all the conditions of true unconscious, like propofol, xenon, midazolam anesthesia, deep non-REM sleep, etc., those have a low value of phi. And it discriminates perfectly, 100% specificity and sensitivity between conscious and not conscious. There is nothing like that there. You can apply it to patients like minimally conscious and vegetative patients that are very difficult to diagnose clinically. And yet, it turns out that indeed, you get it right when it's real suspicious that indeed they are conscious. You get it mostly right also when we suspect they are terminally unconscious, but we get at least 20% of the so-called vegetative clinically unconscious patient to have a high value, which makes us think that there might be somebody there, although they don't behave. It also has IIT a lot of explanatory power, explains why not the cerebellum, why not afferent efferent pathways, why not these loops to the basal ganglia, why not even in deep sleep the neurons are firing, or when you have a generalized seizure they are firing even more than normal, why would consciousness be lost? You can build simple-minded models that show that the cerebellum-like architecture, while very numerous with neurons and connected and so on, breaks down into small modules, so as a whole it doesn't have any phi and the little modules have minimal amounts of it. Same is true for basal ganglia. While some parts of the cerebral cortex are arranged in a way which is ideal for high phi, it is a bunch of grids, essentially 2D grids on top of each other, that, generally speaking, produces very high phi, and that's in some parts of cortex. Now, especially the back of the brain, where these are basically all sort of grids on top of each other. It is the posterior hot zone, we would call it, that seems to be ideally suited anatomically for high phi. And this is a recent experiment which we actually, by awakening subjects in non-REM sleep and REM sleep, we did a within-state no-task paradigm, which is very important because you avoid all kinds of confounding factors that have been there in most experiments so far. Task performance, self-reflection, nothing of the sort. We compare consciousness to unconsciousness. When I wake you up from non-REM sleep, when you're unconscious, there is some delta exactly in this posterior hot zone. There are moments of, as I will show you, breakdown of cause-effect power exactly in the back where we have this grid-like architecture. That's true in non-REM sleep. It's even true in REM sleep, exactly the same areas. And we can even predict online whether you will be saying that you were conscious or not based on exactly the same idea. And the theory predicts that if you go to deep sleep, non-REM, the neuromodulators go down, firing, the neurons are still active, but cause-effect power breaks down. You're not one entity anymore. You break down into many little entities. And recent work, intracranial recordings in epileptic patients in humans, shows that indeed, as predicted, cause-effect power breaks down among neurons in the cortex when you fall unconscious into non-REM sleep. I will finish by just saying that this is work that Larissa did. You know, this provides also at least a principal explanation of why consciousness might have evolved in a biological context. And here are little animates, little creatures that will live in a world where they get fit if they can catch, say, small blocks and avoid big blocks. Whatever the rule, turns out that if the task is difficult enough, they will actually get fit only if they develop an integrated structure which has high phi. And the basic reason for that is that with an integrated structure, you can pack many concepts over a small number of units and connections. And with constraints on number of units and connections, necessarily it will sort of help getting a high integrated information value, that is, high consciousness. So if indeed consciousness is a maximum of intrinsic cause effect power, we also should suspect that there is more consciousness than we had suspected so far in the universe. And I will finish with a quote, which I think is quite appropriate to this crowd and this place. This is a tree falling on the Bow River in Banff. And Schrödinger said, when thinking about why consciousness might have evolved, and he came to humans, he said, would the world otherwise have remained a play before empty benches, not existing for anybody, thus, quite properly speaking, not existing. Thank you.